Thank you so much. I'm really grateful for the opportunity to present an explanation today of the economy of communion. And broadly speaking, what I'd like to do is provide an introduction to the origins and the activities of this initiative, which are really anchored in an inspiration to integrate faith and business life and to aim the purpose of business and economic activity toward what we call building communion. So I'm going to speak to how the economy of communion's global network of small and medium-sized businesses really root themselves in this notion of relationship and live a life of communion at four levels. So today we'll explore this notion of communion within the company itself, with those in need in broader society, within the local community, and then among a global network of like-minded entrepreneurs. The Economy of Communion initiative grew out of the life of the Focolare movement, as was mentioned, which is a Catholic lay ecclesial and ecumenical movement that was founded by Carr in Italy in 1943. And its spirituality of unity is really based on Jesus' prayer for unity in the Gospel of John, that all may be one. The Focolare has spread to 182 countries and counts more than 5 million members of different ages, religions, and backgrounds who work together to foster unity among peoples of the world. And so the Economy of Communion project was actually launched when the founder of Focolare Lubick visited São Paulo, Brazil in May of 1991. And while visiting the Focolare communities of this region, she was impacted by this stark social contrast between the wealthy residences, contrasting with the favelas or the shanty town dwellings on the outside of the city. And she likened this site to a crown of thorns. And Lubick felt a strong sense of urgency to provide for the basic needs of those within the Focolare community who were suffering the terrible poverty of these favelas. Historically, members of the Focolare had practiced what was called a communion of material goods, or a sharing of resources to help those in need. But recognizing its limitations, Lubick began to ask herself if the Focolare could scale its efforts in order to more widely address social and economic inequality. And Lubick felt that the principles of the Focolare spirituality could be extended into the realm of business and industry in order to address root causes of poverty on a structural level. And so she launched the Economy of Communion by calling upon entrepreneurs to start businesses that were committed to sharing their business profits in three parts. One part is to be shared with those in need. One is to be retained for the reinvestment within the business. And another part is to be used for promoting the ideals of an economy of communion, which we'll speak more to later. Furthermore, these businesses were to be infused with the life of the gospel, drawing their inspiration from the first Christian communities as described in the Acts of the Apostles. The community is of one heart and mind. There is no needy person among them. This vision gives rise to the mission of the Economy of Communion, which is to promote a culture of giving and social justice by providing employment opportunities to those in need and fostering workplace environments that support each individual's unique journey and reaching their utmost potential as a valued member of the community. And so today, since 1991, the EOC has grown by, I'm using EOC to refer to the Economy of Communion, has grown to involve approximately 840 small to medium-sized businesses in over 50 countries around the world. The 840 company network includes an incredible variety of companies. About half are professional service-based companies. About 1 in 4 produce products such as violins and clothing. About 1 in 5 are retail businesses. There are about 8,000 EOC employees worldwide, with an average of about 10 employees per company. So they're small firms. And the EOC was launched to help build a society where no one, while the EOC was launched to help build a society where no one is in need, it isn't enough for these businesses to just share profits. It is equally important for them to operate in a certain way. And so business owners take part who take part in the EOC embrace what is called a lifestyle of communion as the fundamental value of their organizations. And so let's turn our attention to discuss what it means to build communion. To understand this EOC's proposal to build communion, it may be helpful to consider Catholic social teaching's understanding of the person, which is a person who is, at one and the same time, both an individual and a relational being. This anthropology is the seat of our inherent dignity and the rationale for mutual love and respect. It is from this anthropology that we draw the ethic that undergirds our economic activity. And in his encyclical Caritas in Veritate, Pope Benedict XVI emphasizes that economic activity must be people-centered. Furthermore, profit from economic activity must be a means and not an end to itself. It's a means to a more humane and just society. The economy of communion articulates its style of communion as, quote, placing the person at the center of the enterprise. This is not the same thing as placing the individual at the center of the enterprise. It means placing a social, relational being at the center of the enterprise, which, understood another way, is saying that the enterprise is for all of us together. At the basis of this lifestyle is an economic ethos centered on the view of the human person, therefore, as ingrained with a vocation to be in relationship, to foster human relationships and, quote, be in communion with another, with others. So we might say that the economy of communion maximizes not profits, but relationships, both outside the company with customers, suppliers, competitors, and others, and inside the company between owners and managers, etc. The marketplace and company are places, therefore, for encounter. So let's turn our attention to how the economy of communion family of companies builds communion on those four levels that was mentioned earlier. First, within the company, the EOC's culture of giving is expressed in the business world as a unique style of relating to others in normal, everyday business practices. So first, let's turn our attention to how this lifestyle of communion is expressed within the company, or as we might call it, or the companies within this network call it, working with an EOC attitude. In many situations, it begins with the owner of the business, his or herself. As one EOC business owner articulates, quote, at the beginning, I had to start with changing myself, with living this vision out in the activities of the company in each moment of the day with whomever God placed within my path. Because of this, I found I could no longer pick and choose who I cared for and loved. I had to love the other worker who was quiet or slow, or perhaps overbearing, or the difficult and demanding client, or a vendor whose delivery is late. I could not exclude anyone because of their position in a company, or lack of position, or their ability to make me look good in front of the boss. I had to see each person as someone worthy of a relationship. The atmosphere within EOC businesses is anchored in recognition of the dignity and value of each stakeholder. Employee, customer, service provider, competitor. To live communion within the workplace means to actively strive to create and sustain workplace conditions that allow for these relationships to develop and flourish. This same entrepreneur recounts, I remember one time during a period when we were very busy at work that the office became, as my mother would call, a pigsty. People were working late hours and not picking up after themselves. Our kitchen was piled with dishes, and no one was making a move to do anything about it. I realized that it would be an act of love for everyone if it was cleaned up. So during lunch, when everyone was out, I went into the kitchen and did all the dishes, scrubbed the counters and sink. When it was spotless, I went back to my office and began working again. Later that same day, someone cleaned up the report production room. Someone began to clean their own work area. Everyone noticed that the atmosphere changed. Stress levels lowered, people seemed to be getting along better, and there was a certain peace that was present among everyone. As time has gone on, these types of experiences have given rise to the articulation of a set of guiding values and principles for the economy of communion businesses that have to do with both internal and external relations for the business. This attitude and lifestyle contained, combined with simple day-to-day experiences, has become the basis for a tool we developed called the Company Cube, which is a practical way of remembering that these values need to be lived
daily within the business environment. So we have developed this company, Cube, and translated it into 6 languages. And there are now many small businesses around the globe who actually roll this cube, identify one aspect of these values to live concretely throughout the activities of the business during that day. And then we have networks of social media where we encourage both employees and business owners to share their experiences of living that particular value within the work environment. True to its spark, the EOC is meant to be much more than a group of businesses who live ethically, though this is a very important part of the project. EOC businesses, like other businesses, seek to produce profits, and the aims of the EOC are reflected in the way that these profits from the businesses are shared. So communion lived within the business becomes communion outside of the business with those in need. In 2012, which was a tough year financially for many of the businesses, the EOC network redistributed just under 900,000 euro. The detailed accounts of those distributions are available on the website. But how is this done in practice? Let us take the 3 parts in turn. The first part goes to helping those living in poverty and is used in a number of ways. Some of the money is used to help people, especially living in the developing world, with basic needs. Over time, however, the EOC has gained more experience in this field, and a greater focus of the work has been on education and training projects. One particular project, which to me sums up the difference the EOC can make, is called Da La Strada, which engages street children in Recife, Brazil, in creating ethically produced recycled handbags, providing disadvantaged youth with a bright future. The EOC's profit sharing is done mainly in collaboration with a non-governmental organization called AMU, or Action for a United World. The second part of the profits is used to promote a culture of giving, or communion. When the EOC started, this is perhaps the most far-sighted and original aspect of the project. Not only does it address the needs of those in poverty today, but it also sets its horizons far through forming people who share this vision and culture capable of living out communion in the business world. This part of the profits shared by businesses supports formation centers and education programs, principally a worldwide youth exchange internship program and a series of summer schools for emerging entrepreneurs. The third part of the profits, as mentioned, is retained within the business to support the development of the business. As well as sharing the profits formally within the EOC, many businesses also develop their own local projects with those living in poverty both locally and internationally. And other businesses build connections with EOC businesses around the world to develop their own collaborations. In many instances, these relationships are not just about a communion of financial resources, but really about sharing time and expertise, or as we might call, a communion of talents. This is the experience of many EOC entrepreneurs who have given their lives to make this project a reality. And so finally, we'll turn our attention to the last 2 levels of communion, which is building communion within the local community, and then within a global network of EOC entrepreneurs. While operating with a vision of the needs of a global family, many EOC businesses in North America have turned their attention in recent years to developing relationships with those near the company, within the local community. And in a spirit of being in relationship with all those who come into contact with the EOC firm, there's a growing emphasis on thinking globally, yet acting locally, and building a culture of giving. EOC firms walk a tightrope between carrying the needs of a global family in heart and mind while acting on the principles articulated within the company cube, which demand a keen awareness of and attention to one's local context. Lastly, EOC firms live in communion within a network of other like-minded businesses. EOC entrepreneurs sustain their vision through contact with a global business-to-business network of other EOC firms throughout the continent and the world. A key example of this business-to-business network can be found in what are called EOC business parks. Some EOC companies are founded in or choose to relocate to these EOC business parks, which are centers for business activity, physical centers, where EOC companies of varying industries and size literally gather to set up shop. In these parks, ideas and support services are incubated, Companies explore methods of cooperation and build relationships, and most importantly, they serve their intended function of being a physical reference point for the project and a center of education and formation in this new style of business and economic activity. Currently, there are 7 business parks operating around the globe. One tutoring company describes their experience of living in communion in the following way, quote, "Although we made a lot more money in our previous jobs, our job now of being an active part of our global family fills us with a sense of gratitude and satisfaction that we could not have imagined. Everyone recognizes that each is important to us and it makes a difference." In conclusion, in speaking with many EOC business owners, several will express a strong sense of purpose and whole self through their involvement with the EOC in the most ordinary and routine activities of their business. For many, the economy of communion was a long-awaited opportunity to integrate religion and business life. In some, those involved in EOC describe it as a calling or a sense of vocation to bring a spirit of communion which is at the heart of faith into the economic world. It is often a difficult choice, but like trailblazers, it's an exciting journey into the unknown. And in 1991, Kara Lubick called the EOC an appointment with history. And in many ways, her words seemed to be prophetic. It was long before the global economic crisis we have witnessed in these previous years. 22 years after the project was launched, this appointment seems to have come of age. Thank you.